Great. Okay, good morning and welcome to yet another lecture on music information retrieval. This is the University of Victoria music information retrieval course, and today I'm going to talk about audio feature extraction in the context of music information retrieval. If you have any questions, feel free to type something in the group chat. You can find a blue icon with lines kind of on the left side of your Google Plus Hangout screen. And I'll try to make a few breaks during my presentation where I will look at the group chat and be able to answer your questions. So at this point, I'm gonna switch to a screencast mode so that I can show you the slides. So let's see, I can do screen share. There we go. Okay. So this looks okay. So the topic of today is audio feature extraction, and this is really starting, we are starting to move into core music information retrieval territory. So far we have mostly been doing an introduction to the basic fundamental concepts in digital signal processing, and more specifically the discrete Fourier transform. So now we're going to see how we can use all that we have learned to extract representations that are useful for music information retrieval tasks. So, okay. I should be okay now. Apologize for that, I just pressed something wrong and my window got minimized. Okay, so things look okay, so you should be able to see this. So the overview of this lecture is that I'm gonna make an introduction to audio feature extraction. Then I'm gonna talk about spectral features, which are features that are computed on the magnitude spectrum that is computed using a discrete Fourier transform or a fast Fourier transform, which is the efficient implementation of the discrete Fourier transform. This will be followed by talking about Mel frequency Kepstrel coefficients, which are a very pervasive audio feature representation in audio signal processing, both for speech and for music. And I will also talk about temporal summarization, which is how do you combine sequences of feature vectors over time into more compact representations, and finish with variants of features that are specific to music that deal with pitch and chroma. So let's see. I need to do this. Okay. So the key idea that we are going to utilize is this idea of a state space representation. So the idea is that if you are modeling some kind of process that changes behavior over time, the way you do it is by representing everything you want to know about this process as a vector of numbers indexed by time. So for every time instance, you have a new vector. And we call that a feature vector, and the space, the dimensional space where that feature vector lives, is called the feature space. So all sorts of things can be modeled that way. For example, you could model the flight path of a bird that has some sensors on it. You could model the stock prices. So for example, the vector, a state space representation for stocks would be the stock prices every day. So that would be a vector of stock prices. And also we can use it to model music in our case. So basically the goal by the end of this lecture is to figure out how we can compute these vectors over time based on what we have learned so far. So another thing to discuss a little bit as an introduction is the different ways you can represent a music track. And all these representations will come into play later on when we discuss how audio feature vectors are used together with data mining and machine learning techniques to build music information retrieval systems. So a music track can be represented as a trajectory of feature vectors over time. So we cut it into small pieces, and then for each of those small pieces, we compute some features, typically based on the spectrum, and therefore we get a sequence that changes over time. So this is depicted in this figure on the left. The red point is a pictorial representation of your feature vector, and it follows this trajectory. Obviously, we will have much higher dimensional feature spaces than the three-dimension space I saw in this picture. Another very common representation is to ignore the ordering of those feature vectors over time and treat them as what's called a bag of features representation. So you basically treat them as an unordered set. The time ordering is completely lost, and you just treat them as a statistical collection of feature vectors. I prefer the term cloud just because it sounds nicer. But the more common term that you will see is a bag of features representation. So on the right, I show you a bag of features representation. Maybe the red dots correspond to a particular piece of music, and the blue points would correspond to a different piece of music. And as the music changes, you get a different red dot or a different blue dot. And finally, one representation that is also quite common is to represent the entire music track with a single feature vector. So everything you want to know is captured as one vector, so you essentially collapse completely the time dimension. So that can be useful if you're doing similarity or classification, because then you can directly apply data mining and machine learning techniques on that representation. So the picture on the right could also be viewed as a picture of a collection of music tracks now, instead of single pieces of music, and where each dot is actually a different music track. So maybe this would represent a genre experiment where all the red dots are a particular music genre, like, let's say, heavy metal music, and all the blue dots are a different musical genre, let's say, classical music. So these are going to all be used, and we're going to see how we can get from one to the other, and also how we can compute them. So the next part we need to discuss is that in the previous lecture, we talked about the discrete Fourier transform, which is a transformation of n complex or real numbers to n complex numbers. And the complex numbers represent the amplitude and the phase of the frequency components, which are the phasors, which are equally spaced in frequency between 0 and the Nyquist frequency. That is half the sampling rate. So, but that only gives us a frequency decomposition of an entire sequence of values. So we could potentially do the discrete Fourier transform over an entire piece of music, but that would be kind of meaningless because we would just find out what frequencies are present, but no information about when these frequencies are present. And given that music changes over time, we're interested not only in which frequencies are present, but also when they take place and when they change. So the idea of the short-time Fourier transform is that you cut your signal into small chunks. For audio, those are typically 10 to 20 milliseconds. And then for each short segment, you compute a spectrum. So now you represent your sequence, your audio, as a sequence of spectra. So it's a sequence of time-varying spectra. And you use the fast Fourier transform to do that implementation. And sometimes, and we will discuss a little bit the reasoning maybe later on, you also overlap those segments. So here in this picture, you see that I'm not taking continuous segments, but there is some overlap between them. And that can be useful, especially when you try to resynthesize data from those time-varying spectra. One other thing I wanted to mention about the short-time Fourier transform is an alternative view, which sometimes can be useful, especially in terms of synthesis, which is that you can view the Fourier transform as a filter bank. So each frequency bin essentially measures the energy at a particular frequency band corresponding to that bin. So you could view it as filtering the signal in a very narrow band in calculating the energy. So if you view it that way, you can think of the discrete Fourier transform as being a bunch of filters, and out of them you estimate the amplitude and the frequency, and then what you could do is you could drive with those amplitude frequencies and phases potentially a bank of sinusoidal oscillators and recreate your signal. So that is what is called a vocoder, and you can do some really interesting synthesis effects using a vocoder. For example, you can modify the pitch without changing the time, or modify the time duration of a signal without changing its pitch, without making it lower. So I'm going to move on. Another thing that happens is that when you when you cut your signal and analyze a segment of it using the DFT, the DFT assumes that that segment repeats periodically. So it's effectively what happens is that it assumes that that signal would be repeated, repeated, repeated. And depending on how exactly you cut it and where you cut it, it might not be a good point to do the repetition. So if, for example, the signal starts at zero, and then because of my window size, which is usually determined by the size of the FFT, I cut it right here, I will have a discontinuity when I repeat it between the zero and the 1.7 or something that is this peak. So what needs to happen is we need to reduce the effect of that discontinuity, and that can be done by a process called windowing. So I will quickly show you what windowing does. So windowing, what it does is it applies an envelope function to your original time domain signal. So here you see a time domain signal which is corresponds to some piece of music, and here you see the same signal windowed. So you can see that the middle values remain about the same, but the values at the edges get tapered down close to zero. And what that has the effect of is that when you repeat them, you don't have as many artifacts. So another way to view it is that instead of using as basis functions the sinusoids that we have been talking about, your basis now are windowed sinusoids, which have sort of this shape. So obviously, if you were to only use these windows and try to reconstruct, your audio signal would be modulated by the window shape and would sound strange. Instead, what you can do is you can overlap the windows, and by overlapping them, you can reconstruct completely your signal. And that is called overlap add resynthesis, and it's something that I believe there's one question in assignment one that it investigates. So there's a lot of different windows. You can they have different properties in terms of what's their effect on the frequency domain. I'm not going to spend time talking about that, but there's lots of resources both on the web and on books on audio signal processing about different windows and their effect on the frequency domain. So a little bit about the history of audio features. So the origins of audio features for music processing lay in speech processing. So speech processing existed quite a bit for, you know, 10 or 20 years, starting with research in Bell Labs, and So there was much more advances that had happened in speech processing. Essentially, audio music processing started in the end of the 80s, maybe in the beginning of the 90s. And by that time, there were some audio features that have been proposed in speech. So it seemed natural when people first started looking at music to try them out. Another type of work that has influenced the design of audio features is work in characterizing timbre, mostly in psychology and psychoacoustics. So we'll talk a little bit about that later. And eventually, there were features, and that's still an ongoing area of research, so there are still papers published on some new feature or not some new representation that are specific to music processing. So one example is chroma, and that relates information about pitch. And another example is rhythmic patterns, which we're going to talk later in this course. So also pitch, the feature that we talked about in the previous lecture on monophonic pitch detection, is an example of an audio feature. Unlike measured pitch, audio features do not necessarily have a direct perceptual correlate. In other words, we will be computing these numbers over audio, but if you ask me, what exactly does this number mean, I can give you a hand-waving explanation, but I cannot define it precisely like pitch. I cannot run a matching experiment with users to see what they do. So these are just sort of different ways of characterizing the information that are statistical in nature and can be used later on with machine learning algorithms. Okay, so at this point, I will take a short break and check if there are any questions. So feel free to type your questions to the group chat while I'm talking, and then it will be we will save some time. So I will switch to my face. So hi, everyone. And let me see if there's anything on the group chat. Okay. There's a question by Raphael. Why not using windows of different sizes, dynamically changing, I mean? So the answer is you can do that. In fact, actually, there is a method of singing and speech time frequency analysis called PSOLA. Which stands for pitch synchronous overlap add. And the idea there is that if you know the pitch of your sound, you can adjust your window so that they fit the pitch. And that way you don't get as many artifacts. The problem with that is you need to know what the pitch is. So you need to work with monophonic signals that you can detect the pitch. If you have an arbitrary music signal, it's not clear how you would dynamically change the window size. You could certainly do it, but it's not clear what criterion you would use to do that. There actually, something like that happens in MPEG compression, where they change the window size for if you have transient events, you use small window sizes, and if you have more long events, you use longer window sizes. So that's kind of roughly the question. Another thing you can do is you can run multiple window sizes in parallel and then somehow combine the results. That's called a multi-resolution STFT, and it's been used. So it's a very good question. There's no straightforward answer, but there's quite a bit of work in it. Okay, so I don't see any other questions at the group chat, but as I mentioned, if you if something comes to your mind while I'm going through the slides, type it in. All right, so I'm going to go back to the slides now. So start screen share. Okay. So now I'm going to talk about spectral features. So first, I want to give you the very big picture. So if you look, this is a picture that I made a while ago. So on the top is the time domain signal of a 10-second excerpt from a piece of music. So you can just see. As you can see, there's not a lot of information in that. You can see some information about the changes in dynamics. For example, here there's sort of a more quiet section, but there's not a lot of information that you can tell from just a time domain waveform plot. At the bottom, we have the spectrogram, which is basically computing the DFT using the FFT for every time instance, then taking the magnitude spectrum or the amplitude spectrum. So each value of a DFT bin is a complex number. You convert it to polar form. You throw away the phase, and you just plot those sequences. And that's what we call a spectrogram. Now, a spectrogram contains about the same amount of information as the audio signal. Actually contains exactly, well, not exactly because of the phase. But if we keep the phase, we can take the spectrogram and the phase spectrogram and combine them, and we can get back our original signal. So there's a lot of numbers here. Like, each one of those columns might be 1,024 numbers or 2,048, and you might have 1,000 of these columns. So that's just too much information for data mining algorithms. So one thing we'd like to do is to summarize across frequency. So we can take our spectrum of, let's say, 1,024 points, and through a process called Mel frequency Kepstral coefficients, we will reduce it to 10 or 20 points. And that's illustrated here. So we get a sequence of Mel frequency Kepstral coefficients, which is much smaller in this dimension compared to the original spectrogram. But I still might have 1,000 vectors, each one might have 13 coefficients, so I still would like to reduce more my data. And one way to do it is to look at how those feature vectors evolve over time. So take a smaller segment, maybe 1 second, and then somehow characterize the evolution of these feature vectors in that segment, which we'll call the texture window. And that's what ends with the final feature vector. So there is the analysis window in the time domain waveform, which is used to compute the spectrum. And then in the sequence of features computed over the spectrum, you can think of this as a new signal at the lower sampling rate. You also do a segment, and you also do some kind of processing. OK, so that's the big picture. So now we'll go into some of the specifics. So one family of features are what are called spectral shape features. So these are features that try to capture information about the shape of the spectrum, but without storing all the details. So the centroid is the center of gravity of the spectrum, and we will define it later on. And the roll-off is shows the energy distribution between low and high frequencies. And the flux shows how much the sound changes in a spectral sense from time to time. So these features were inspired by work in 1975, where what Gray did was he investigated how human beings perceive different sounds in terms of instrument sounds. So he played, let's say, a clarinet note, and then played a bassoon note, and then played a violin note, and then asked people to sort them by similarity. So for maybe the clarinet would be similar, more similar to a bassoon than it is to a violin. A violin would be more similar to a viola. So once you get all those similarity rankings, there's a technique called multidimensional scaling, which we might cover later on. I'm not exactly sure if I will cover it or not, which basically takes all those similarity ratings and creates a lower dimensional space where, with some sort of arbitrary dimensions, that captures those similarities. So in other words, if two of those objects are sounds, and I measure their distance in this 3D space, their distance roughly will be proportional to their similarity in the user experiments. And then what you can do is look at these dimensions and see, what do they represent? And it turns out that these, the centroid and the roll-off and the flux, are good correlates of how these dimensions behave. So things will be sorted in terms of centroid in one direction and flux. And so notice that these are descriptors for individual instruments, not for mixtures of instruments like music. But basically, essentially, what people said is, why don't we try them and see what happens? So it seems like a reasonable approach to, from one spectrum that might have 1,024 samples, to get three numbers, which is much more manageable. So here's the definition of the centroid. It's the center of gravity of the spectrum, and it correlates with pitch and brightness. So if your sound doesn't change, notes with a higher pitch will have a higher centroid. But if you have notes of the same pitch and you have different instrument sounds, like you know, a trumpet and let's say a bassoon playing the same note, then the trumpet will have a higher centroid. I apologize for the sound. This is my phone ringing. I'll just let it ring and get back to it after this lecture. So here you can see that the centroid is expressed as the weighted combination of the magnitude values of the spectrum. So Xn is the spectrum at analysis window n and at frequency bin k. So it's and n is the DFT size. So it's relatively easy to compute, and then you get one number for every analysis window. So for every column of the spectrogram, you get one centroid. Here is the definition for the roll-off. It's the frequency below which 85% of the energy in the magnitude spectrum is concentrated. If you start from bin 0, and start adding energy, so I add the energy of bin 0, bin 1, bin 3, bin 4, at some point, and I reached a frequency for which the current sum is equal to 85% of the total sum. And that particular frequency, Rn, which is this frequency, is what we call the roll-off. So again, it's just a single number that gives you a sense of the balance between high and low frequencies in the spectrum. So I won't talk about flux, and there's other features that can be computed out of a spectrum, but the basic idea is you get your magnitude spectrum, and then you calculate some statistics, and then those statistics describe your underlying audio signal. The other, so I'll now take another break and see if there are any questions. So also catch a little bit my breath. So switching to this mode and checking. Okay, so there's a question by Vivek. I have difficulty associating timbre with frequency content. Can you explain? Yes, so if you look at spectra, I mean, that was one of the main findings early on by Helmholtz, was that if you look at the spectra of different instruments, so if I play the same pitch, the harmonics of the instruments are the same. So in terms of what frequencies are there, they're approximately the same. But what changes is the weight of those harmonics. So the sound of an instrument, to some extent, it also depends on how it changes over time. But to some approximation, especially if you have sounds that are steady, like the sound of an organ or someone holding a note on a violin, what the quality that distinguishes sounds of the same pitch and loudness, which we call timbre, is mostly based on the spectrum and the frequency content. So that's the answer. And Raphael's answer is also pretty good and reflects that. Stephen Harrison is asking why 85%. It's actually kind of arbitrary, and in fact, if you look at specific implementations, sometimes people use 90%, sometimes they use 80. It's just kind of an arbitrary number. So it looks like There are no more questions, so that's great. I'm glad this is mechanism is kind of working. So I'll return to showing my slides. All right. So now I'm going to talk about the male frequency Kestrel coefficients, which are really probably the most used audio feature representation in the world. If you have ever interacted with a dialogue system, a computerized dialogue system, or if you have used speech recognition when you call your credit card and you talk to a computer, what's happening is that male frequency Kestrel coefficients are computed and used for speech recognition. So let's look at them a little bit and see how they work. So the main idea behind male frequency Kestrel coefficients was to try to approximate how we perceive frequencies, so how the human ear works, rather than just having the frequencies linearly spaced, which is the output of the DFT. So the DFT outputs frequencies that are linearly spaced. What we are interested in frequencies that are spaced more close to how our perceptual system does. And for those of you who have who watched the lecture on monophonic pitch detection, you remember that we talked about perceptual scales and how by using just noticeable difference experiments, you can look at what's the perception of frequency. And it turns out that even though there is quite a bit of disagreement in what exactly that threshold is, we can view low frequency perception as a linear spacing, and higher frequencies are perceived in a log space. So what the male scale approximation, which is used in male frequency Kestrel coefficient, does is to use 13 linearly spaced filters and 27 log spaced filters. And the way those filters are implemented are simply as triangles that combine values of the spectrum. So you can think of it as multiplying your spectrum with a triangle, and the tip of the triangle is centered at a center frequency, and the boundaries of a triangle are determined based on the spacing. So the lower frequency triangles are spaced in terms of linear spacing. So the lower boundary is minus 130, the higher boundary is plus 130. So those will sort of the triangle shapes will remain constant. The log-spaced filters are, instead of using a difference, they use a division and a multiplication. So as you can imagine, those triangles stretch over time and become much larger and sum more terms in the frequency representation. So that stage is what's called the male filtering. So 13 plus 27, you get 40 values, one for each of that these channels, if you want to think of them, that roughly correspond better to perception. Then you take that energy and you apply a log transformation, and we will, this is a little bit of a hack, if you want. It's not a very clearly justified step, but there is some theory behind it, so I'll mention that briefly. But if you really start asking questions, it's not exactly correct. But anyway, it does seem to do part of the trick. And the final step is this discrete cosine transform that I will describe in a second. So the Kestrel is this idea that if you have a sound that is harmonic, so it has frequencies that are multiples of a fundamental frequency, then the spectrum will have peaks that are regularly spaced. So in some ways, a periodic spectrum will have regular peaks and a non-periodic spectrum will not. So you can actually try to find frequencies in the frequency domain, which sounds like a strange thing, but it works, and it's called a Kestrel. So another way to think of it is that if you model the sound of the voice, and remember that since male frequency Kestrel coefficients were designed for speech recognition, their main interest was the voice, a first degree approximation is that the voice consists of two signals, an excitation, which happens at your vocal folds, and a filter, which is the shape of your mouth and your tongue, which is what is called the vocal tract, which shapes that excitation. So if I was to cut your head and have air go through your vocal folds, you would hear a buzzing sound, something like ee-beep, something like that. But by having your head and your mouth, that excitation buzz turns into a sound like ah or oh. And notice that as you change the vowel, the shape of your mouth changes. So H is the shape of your mouth. E is the excitation, which also determines the pitch of the sound. So if I sing oh, oh, I sing different pitches. By the way, I just want to also mention that... no, I forgot what I wanted to say. Okay, so we'll move on. So if you have this relation, what happens when you have a filter is that you can view the filter as having a frequency response, basically showing which frequencies get enhanced and which get reduced. And that frequency response is multiplied by the frequency response of the excitation. So if I take the log of the magnitude spectrum of the composite signal, which is my voice, it can be represented as a sum of the excitation plus the sum, the log, or so if you do a log, the convolution of the two signals becomes equivalent to the sum of their log spectra or the capstra. So that's the idea. And the point is that what we hope to happen is that the low coefficients in the MFCC representation will model the filter shape, and the higher order coefficients will model the excitation with a possible fundamental frequency. So that's the little bit of a hand-waving explanation, but gives you some of the original motivation for MFCCs. Now, when you apply MFCCs to music, there is not a single voice or sound. So in some sense, the model doesn't fit really well, but it's just a way you can summarize your spectrum. And in practice, it works relatively well. It's just a way of reducing dimensions in a way that preserves interesting information. The last part, which is the discrete cosine transform, or the DCT, is basically done so that you can further reduce your data. So it has the property that the low coefficients represent most of the signal, and the higher ones can be discarded. And we will talk a little bit later about this. Just to give you a quick hint, if you remember in the lecture about the discrete Fourier transform, we talked about coordinate systems. And if you have a certain signal, or a certain number of points, you can think of maybe there is an optimal coordinate system for describing that set of points. And that idea is something called the Carhoun and Loewe transform, which also relates to something called principal component analysis. We will be revisiting that when we talk about dimensionality reduction and visualization. But the DCT is kind of an approximation of that, and it's quite similar. When you do audio signals, the results are quite similar. So in the MFCCs that we use, we keep something like 13 or 20 coefficients. So we start from the spectrum, which might have 2048 or 1024, then that gets reduced to 40 with the MEL filter bank, and then that gets reduced through the DCT to 13 or 20 coefficients. Also, I just wanted to mention that the discrete cosine transform, or at least a variant of it called the modified discrete cosine transform that takes advantage of overlap, is used in all most audio compression standards like AP3, MP3s and AAC files. Okay, so now we're going to talk a little bit about temporal summarization. I am looking at the group chat, and I don't see any questions. So I'll just take a quick break, just in case there are some questions. All right, so highest frequency of MFCC 20 coefficient is around 3,000. Well, it depends on what your sampling rate is. By themselves, the MFCCs don't tell you that. It really depends on your sampling rate. Or maybe not, you're right. Actually, well, it's not exactly 130 because the higher coefficients go logarithmically. So you can work it out. It is true, though, that because they divide your spectrum sort of in the same way, they actually do the frequency that an MFCC coefficient corresponds does not change if you change the sampling rate. Although you could do MFCCs that have more than 40 values in their filter bank, and then there are some experiments about that. If you are interested, you can email me or I post the question actually on the Google Plus community, and I think I can probably dig it out. There was a nice paper that kind of had a description of all different variants of MFCCs and experiments with different number of filter banks and so forth over some data sets. So it was a nice kind of concise reference about MFCCs. Okay, so I'll go back to the slides. And again, you know, feel free to type the questions and I'll double check them again when we go back to a breakpoint. So I'm starting screen sharing. So the next part is temporal summarization. And that part actually is a little bit, maybe a mess is too much of a strong term, but the problem is that there's no consistent terminology. So if you read papers, you see that they do the same thing, but they call it many different names. And so what I'm going to try to do is at least make you understand that all these are essentially variations of the same main idea. We have a sequence of feature vectors and we try to summarize them over time. So a variety of terms have been used to describe methods that summarize a sequence of feature vectors over time. And a typical frame size for computing feature vectors is 10 to 20 milliseconds. And frequently we try to summarize them over 1 to 3 seconds. And the time scale of 1 to 3 seconds is an interesting time scale because that's where a lot of the basic information we extract from music happens at that scale. So for example, if I play you 10 milliseconds of a piece of music, you just hear a blip. But if I play you 1 second, you can tell, for example, if it's classical music or heavy metal. You might not be able to tell what group it is or whether you really like it, but at least the kind of rough idea of what the music is you can get in 1 to 3 seconds. So terms that have been used for this process are texture windows. That was a term I used originally. Aggregates is another common term. When using modulation, they are called modulation features. So that's when you compute a feature and you detect periodicity in the time sequence of that feature. So for example, you could pick the MFCC coefficient 5 and then see how that changes over time and detect periodicities. And these periodicities typically happen at the note level and the rhythmic level. Another way you can introduce time is what are called dynamic features. For example, delta features are a common choice where you include your features, but also include the difference of the current value of the feature with the previous value of the feature. So that gives you sort of a first approximation to how these change over time. Another term that has been used is temporal feature integration. Fluctuation patterns is a specific type of such aggregation. And then if you read papers that come more from neural networks and deep learning, a term that is used there is pooling. And pooling is also kind of the same idea. And song level refers to when this summarization is done across the entire track rather than a shorter window. Okay, so hopefully by throwing all these names at you, when you read a paper, you will be able to understand that they are all referred to the same underlying idea. It's just that there's no consistent terminology. So I will just show you one example of the type of temporal summarization we might want to do. So here we have a texture window of size M starting at feature index N, which can be summarized by a mean and standard deviation. So what I mean by that is that for for every particular feature vector, so let's say we pick MFCC coefficient 5, I keep the last M values of that MFCC coefficient. So I keep the last 10 or 20 values. And then I replace, or I add to the value, the current value of the MFCC, I also compute the average of the last 10 values. And I also compute the standard deviation of the last 10 values. So you can think of it as a moving average or a moving standard deviation. And here I have some plots that I think are interesting and illustrate that point. So first I'm going to play you two pieces of music. So the first is a piece of music by the Beatles. And just listen to it. So if someone could confirm at the group chat that you could hear this piece, that would be good. I'm not sure if it came through. Okay, so that's great. So now let's listen to another piece of music. And this is from a recording of a piece by Debussy. Okay, so this is from La Mer. And what you see in the left plot, so the centroid plot right here, is the blue lines are the Beatles track, and the green line, the green plot, is the centroid of the classical music. So as you can see, the centroid of the classical music is higher. And that makes sense because the Beatles have bass and a bass drum and have lower frequencies. So the centroid is on average higher. But notice that in many cases, in the Beatles example, it actually has some really high centroid values. So it alternates between low centroid values and high centroid values. And that's because in rock music you have this kind of rhythm where there is the bass and the snare and hi-hat, and these alternate, and these rhythmic events change the centroid. So they don't only different in the average, but also in the amount of variation. And if you just look at these plots, it's hard to see these trends. But if you look at the moving average, so that's the plot in the middle, you can clearly see that on average, the Beatles have a lower centroid than the classical music. But when you look at the plot of standard deviation, it's clear that the Beatles have higher standard deviation than the classical music. So these are the types of features that maybe, you know, that kind of thing might lead you to think, okay, well, maybe if I can tell apart one particular piece of music from another part based on style, maybe I could use those features with some more general things like genre classification. And that's exactly what we're going to do. So in the next lectures, we will also do an introduction to the fundamentals of data mining and machine learning. And then once we have that armed with audio feature extraction, we will finally be able to put together some interesting music information retrieval systems. Okay, so I'm going to move on. And I'm going to now take a quick break and look if there are any questions. So I just saw a question by Rafael. What are some common size durations of M and in which applications? So a common size is something like typically, if you have analysis windows around 20 milliseconds, then if you have something like 50 of them, you get 1 second. So M is somewhere between 40 or 80. Sometimes it can even be smaller, like 10. Typical values are between 10 and 100. Also, sometimes the moving average is not done in every location of the feature vector, so you can actually compute it in segments and advance the segments. So that's also a possibility. So you could average every 1 second, and then if you have a 30-second piece, you would get a sequence of 30 feature vectors, something like that. So typically, the durations are at that mid-size, between 1 second and 3 seconds. Okay, so I will go back to the slides and talk about the last feature representation, which is pitch histograms and chroma. So in the same way that we combined DFT bins to map them to a filter bank, the MEL filter bank, we can use the same scheme to map DFT bins to MIDI nodes. So we simply, if you remember in the monophonic pitch extraction lecture, I had a formula where you could convert a frequency to a MIDI note number. So you just run that formula for every DFT bin, and you find out for every DFT bin which MIDI note number does it map to. And what you will find is that there, especially at higher frequencies, there will be multiple DFT bins that map to the same MIDI note number. So somehow you need to combine their values. And there are different averaging shapes that you could use. You could just do a simple average, you could use a triangle, or you could use some kind of Gaussian. So there is some variation there, but the basic idea is that you combine bins of the DFT to get a representation that is histogram over MIDI note numbers. If you desire, you can fold the resulting histogram, collapsing bins that belong to the same pitch class into one. So this will not make much sense unless you understand a little bit more about music theory, but if you think of the piano, by doing the pitch histogram, we are finding how much energy there is in each piano key. If I take all the C keys of the piano and add their energy, and all the C sharp keys and add their energy, and essentially fold the whole thing into one octave, 12 notes, then that's what's called a chroma. So sometimes you actually use more than 12 bins per octave to account for tuning and performance variation. So sometimes pitch histograms will have a smaller granularity. Another alternative way of doing it, you could perform multiple pitch detection, which we haven't talked that much about, but let's say you have some method for detecting pitches and add the detected pitches to a histogram and do it over time. So both of those have been used. They have advantages and disadvantages. The DFT method is straightforward and ensures that everything kind of gets into your representation. The problem is if you have sounds that are not mapping to pitches, like drum sounds and percussion, they tend to add noise and make the chroma harder to interpret. The problem with multiple pitch detection is that sometimes it doesn't work and it's more brittle, so it's not a straightforward process where you can just fold your spectrogram. One last note is that when you map a single sound, like if I have a single note, it also consists of harmonics. So when you take the spectrum of that note, it will not just add energy to the corresponding MIDI note number, but will also add energy to other notes that correspond to the harmonics of that. So that's another source of errors when you compute pitch histograms this way. So here is an old figure from a paper that I did a while ago, and it shows the pitch histograms of two jazz pieces, which are at the left column, and two Irish folk music pieces. And just eyeballing them, you can see that the histogram of jazz is much more dense, and that's something you expect because jazz music has a lot of chord changes, has a lot of tonalities, it modulates a lot, so you will get most of the notes somehow. In Irish folk music, it tends to stay in one key, it only has a few chords, so you see that the histogram is sparse. So as you can imagine, maybe you can compute some features on the histogram itself, for example, something that measures sparsity, and use that to characterize music. Okay. So as I mentioned in the monophonic pitch detection lecture, we perceive pitch as from low to high, but we also have this octave equivalence where the sound of a middle C and a higher C, we name them the same. They have this special relation. And that's reflected in this pitch helix. So we can do the same thing. We can take our spectrum and map it to a chroma representation, and here you can see that instead of having all these harmonics, they get a little bit more concentrated. So I'm going to show you some chroma profiles. So these are our old friends, the C4 sine wave and the C4 clarinet note, and this is the chroma profile of a C4 note, and what you expect is to see a peak at C4, and indeed there is a peak for the sine wave. However, when you do it for the clarinet, there's not a peak where there should be one, but there's one at the first harmonic. So that shows you that the chroma is not exactly perfect. If I do chromas over time, I have what's called a chromagram, and here you can see that you can kind of see how the chromagram changes in terms of melody and maybe gives you an indication of whether it's going up or down. So chromograms can be used for chord detection, but also for doing stuff related to melody. So this, I'll just play this quick sound quickly. So three notes, you can see them notated down here and the corresponding chromograms. So this concludes the lecture, and in summary, the short-time Fourier transform with windowing forms the basis of extracting time-frequency representations, in most cases magnitude spectrograms, from audio signals. The process of audio feature extraction consists of summarizing in various ways the information in the frequency dimension and across the time dimension. So there is tons of literature. I regularly review papers that propose some new variation of audio feature extraction, but at the end of the day, all they do is they have basically two formulas, one formula for taking the spectrum and computing features that summarize frequency, and another formula that is taking values over time and summarizes them over time. And if you have that big picture in your head, you will be able to read those papers and implement them and understand them. Originally, audio features used in music information retrieval were inspired by automatic speech recognition and psychological investigations of timbre. Additional features capturing information specific to music, such as chroma and pitch histograms, have also been proposed. So I'm going to now switch to face display, and I will take any last questions, and this will conclude the lecture. So switching off screen sharing. So are there any remaining questions? All right. So if anything pops up to you later on, feel free to ask questions regarding the lecture in the Google Plus discussion and category, and I'm looking forward to being in touch with you. And thank you very much, and I'll see you later. Also, remember that today I'm going to try to do my actual physical lecture, not in my office, live through Hangouts at 2:30 Pacific time. So see you then, and that will be an introduction to data mining. Take care. Bye-bye.